1,200 miles off the coast of New England, it's one of the richest fishing grounds on Earth. The Grand Banks.
Yeah, baby.
Home to brutal weather and unpredictable seas. This is where the perfect storm exploded. Over the years, thousands of lives have been lost here. Yet every fall, a few brave fishermen risk everything as they sail these deadly waters in search of giants. More than half the fall season is over. The fleet captains have rolled the dice.
Holy man!
Some have won.
Woo!
Others have lost.
God, it sucks. I'm ready to get out of here.
Now, life is on the line as the search for swords continues. Miles east of New England is the 90-foot Eagle Eye. Veteran Captain Scotty Drabinowitz is pushing his crew hard into their 50th day since leaving home. It's late October, just 17 days remain in the toughest part of the season.
I put it to the guys that we were making extra sets. They said fine. I'm quite sure they want to go home. I want to go home.
We were supposed to go in, and then Scott decided, I guess it'd be best for us to stay out for another 10 sets. Yeah, a little frustrated. We got a good catch on here. I was ready to go in.
The fact of the matter is, this trip is not over until we're out of bait.
2 days ago, the Eagle Eye 2 was resupplied by the Seahawk. Scotty is now hoping the extended trip will pay off with a record-breaking haul.
Really, this trip has just been a grind for me. We're really, really working and really putting in some long hours for these fish.
And could be the difference between a $10,000 trip and a $20,000 trip for the crew.
Very busy.
Under the best conditions, each set will take 18 to 20 hours to complete. That means at least 8 more days at sea.
Talk about a crazy day. We got it.
Well, we got rain just to top it all off.
It's a wet day today. Swimming on deck.
Windy. Sucks today. Well, that's, we gotta do it, but it sucks.
Swordfish love to hunt the perfect mix of warm and cold water currents. But conditions start to change this late in October. After 10 hooks, the first bite. Captain Scotty's got a few fish in the boat. But the rough weather and building seas are adding extra weight to the already strained mainline. He's pushed it too far.
Far it off.
We had a part off. Wind kicked up, waves kicked up, started raining, man, it's a mess. I don't even know what happened. I don't think anybody knows what happened.
The crew rides out the storm on the bow, looking for one of the small buoys attached to their main line.
We're looking for our gear to haul it back up. We can't fish without it.
And conditions aren't making it easy.
Got about 25 foot wave.
I end up all there.
They found the gear, but there's a problem.
They're moving with us.
Yeah. Scotty, I think we haven't seen that bird because the boy moving with us.
Is it?
Yeah.
All right.
The missing gear is hung up on the stabilizing bird's outrigger chain.
Hey, get the throw grapple!
The crew muscles the loose gear toward the stern.
There you go, good shot. Get mono cutters.
Hoping to avoid a disastrous tangle with the 4-foot-wide propeller known as the wheel.
Think it's in the wheel. Yeah.
Cut one of them and pull it out of the bird. Pull it out of the bird.
All right.
See if you can walk it to the stern.
I don't think it's in the wheel. It's going right midship. Wait.
With their missing gear recovered, the crew is back to hauling through the storm.
All right, let her go, Brian.
Let her go, Brian.
We got her back on the road here now. We're heading back down the highway.
So far, Captain Scotty's gamble isn't paying off.
We got the weather, we got the part-offs. Welcome to paradise, baby.
Ah! 80 miles to the south is the little southern boat, Big Eye. After a slow start, Captain Chris Chompers Hansen finally put some fish in his hole.
How do you make it? How do you when you have nothing and you start from the bottom? It's hard. It's hard. I know how, because I started from the bottom and I am still on the bottom. I'm in debt up to my ears. So it's like I can't stop. There's no way of stopping. That's what drives Chris Hansen. That's exactly what drives it, because I don't want to lose it. I don't want to lose it.
With conditions changing fast, Chompers has to move to the north to a sweet spot on the temperature break. But he's been beaten to it by another boat, the Seahawk, under Captain Linda Greenlaw.
Copy, Linda.
Yeah, I got you good, Chris. Come in.
Tonight's our last night. We're all done. Throw it in the water and haul it back.
Head for Newfoundland, are?
Yeah, I'm envious. Good for you.
Their communication is cordial. But the last time they met, Captain Chompers set his gear in Linda's path.
I'm watching them haul gear off the top of my gear.
Yeah, really going across our line?
Ha! Look at the he's got towing there.
No. Oh.
That's what friends like Chopper are for.
You're looking to move up, or?
Yeah, we'd like to move up, Linda.
There ain't no green pasture down here. I mean, we had 20 fish, but we only had three or four markers.
He said I'm going to spend a little time looking around.
It's not going to start too early.
Best we can do is try and find the best part of the break here.
Give me a shout when you're getting ready to get lined up there.
Thanks for the comeback. Stand by.
Yes, ma'am, we'll be standing by.
Right now, it's Linda's call where to drop her gear, and the pressure is on.
It's almost funny to try and make a plan because the water changes up so fast, especially this time of year, that, you know, I have a game plan, but.
Linda was first on the fishing grounds, so Chompers should wait to see where she goes before starting. But patience isn't one of his virtues.
Let it go!
Without even a courtesy call, the Big Eye begins setting out. Only miles away and unaware of the Big Eye, the Seahawk begins their set as well. Right now, their chief concern is whether the new greenhorn will prove himself.
Okay, when you get ready to clip,
yeah.
Hold the bait until just before you clip on. That way you're not, and throw it out like behind you, out that way.
Yeah, fighting with it.
When you tow it, Tom, it can rip it off. Okay. You don't want to be setting that many hooks.
Coming out on a boat like this and getting to fish the Grand Banks. You know, you get to hear a lot of old-time fishermen say that. But, you know, me just being new into the industry, being able to jump right into it, I think it's pretty exciting. I wasn't going to turn down the opportunity.
That's a nice one right there.
As both lines play out, the currents could turn this set into a tangled mess. It's a gamble this desperate captain is willing to make. Hundred miles from Newfoundland, the Seahawk is about to start their haul back under Captain Linda Greenlaw.
We don't have all that many days to fish because of the schedule, but I didn't hear any big fish reports, so we'll see what happens.
Hey, you ready for your first sword?
Yeah.
Greenhorn Nate Clark performed well during last night's set out, but hauling back is a very different challenge.
Hopefully all that hard work we did yesterday will pay off. I think it's gonna get a lot harder here in a few minutes though.
Ready? One, two, three. Good to go.
Okay, Lenny, we're hauling.
The first hook comes back empty.
Clip it up, Nate, just clip them up.
But the second has something on the line.
Is it keeper?
Yeah, I think so. That's definitely big enough. Get a gaff and I'm gonna cut your leader, okay?
That was fast.
Yeah, you aren't kidding.
It's the only one I've seen.
After a promising start, the fishing remains steady.
No, be going from the top up, that's it.
And young greenhorn Nate is keeping pace.
There you go, right in. Perfect. Little ones for you.
A third of the way through the haul, they've caught 10 fish.
Pretty exciting first day. Get to see nice sized swordfish come up.
The fishing is good, but not spectacular.
No, won't make it. It's too skinny.
Linda had hoped for more from such a good piece of water.
It was a totally different run of fish. Certainly not the fish we had last trip. I'm hoping there's still a few nice ones left, but what we've got so far today, not looking too special.
And the reason why could be just a few miles away. With 18,000 pounds of fish already in the hole, Captain Chompers wanted one more big day. So last night, he snuck into some prime water ahead of the Seahawk.
And I think I come up here and I've done my best. I don't know about coming up here and showing them that I'm somebody special or anything like that, because I'm not. I think I've come up here and showed them that that I can hold my own.
Nice! Fish. Been blessed with some good fishing here this morning. Pretty good so far. Having a good last day.
The Big Eye and the Seahawk are now less than a mile apart, and Linda is surprised to see Chompers so close.
You know, he asked me how much room I needed. I told him, and they said, well, I won't be anywhere near where you want to be. But he didn't do what he said he was going to do, so.
I don't care what she says. This is a big ocean, you know? That's the way Chompers does things. He don't do halfway. I go all the way. Just like if you're gonna see a big dog and you're gonna pick on it, you might as well go and crack it right in the head. You're gonna do it all the way.
Chris has his own way of doing things.
See how I got to look at the lightning, a little taste of it.
What do you
the new generation, young kids, young people, the younger version of the fishermen. We're a hell of a lot faster.
It's the last hook of the trip for the big eye. And it comes up good.
Hey, yeah.
This triple marker sword makes it a total of 20,000 pounds for the trip.
Come in like a lamb, going out like a lion. The last thing anybody out here wants to hear me say is I'm going in with my boat full. I'm not feeling that welcome around here.
Depending on the market price, the crew stands to make $5,000 for just this portion of the trip.
If we don't run into any weather, we'll make real good time in there.
Once the boats start reaching port, thousands of pounds of fish flood the market, dropping the price. If the big eye doesn't reach port first, Chompers and his crew could lose thousands of dollars.
Once again, Grand Banks, adios for another year. If I live to see next year, you will see me again.
5 miles north, the crew of the Seahawk has completed their haul back with 19 swords. Not the number she was expecting.
It wasn't the most productive day, so I'm gonna start in the cold water tonight and just angle sort of to the southwest and hopefully gradually warm it up.
New greenhorn Nate's performance on deck has made an impression.
Nate did great today.
Yeah, he's a hustler. He's
really
running
well
up and down the deck and good with the gaff. And nice to have a young guy, those young legs, you know, run up and down the deck. Now I guess we'll try another set in the same area. There's nowhere good to run to, so.
15-minute warning,
that's right.
Having decided to stay put, Linda gives the orders to set. Crewman Dave heads off to prepare the bait, but the curse of the Seahawk is about to strike again with a vengeance.
Oh, Archie, I just got electrocuted.
Where?
What happened? Stay away. Look at me, Dave.
1,100 miles off the coast of Newfoundland, aboard the Seahawk, Captain Linda Greenlaw has given the order to set the gear. On deck, crewman Dave Hiltz heads for the setting shack to turn on the lights and start prepping the bait.
Archie, I just got electrocuted.
Where?
The day's deckhand has just taken 110 volts.
Stay away. Look at me, Dave. All right? Huh? Look at me.
Where am I?
You're in the wet closet. Stay right here. Just stay right here. Look, how long was the shock going in your back there?
Holding you
there?
Yeah. Hand hurts, Archie.
Yeah, I'm sure it does. Let's get your jacket off. What happened?
Got electrocuted.
Where?
Plug in the back.
At the stern, Dave unknowingly touched the shorted out plug. The electricity raced up his arm, through his body, and down to the wet metal below deck. The sudden jolt caused Dave's muscles to violently contract, leaving him frozen in place, unable to move or let go.
Yes.
You've got pretty good electrocution.
What?
There's stuff on the lights back there, so he's down, he's awake, but he's not even close to the floor.
Where is it?
Hey, look at me,
alright?
Keep looking at me,
alright? Now look at me, too.
Lenny's here. Look at Lenny.
What is he? Hi. What'd you latch on to?
You went to plug the light in back there, back, I guess, and then he got stuck right to it. He couldn't get off.
Yeah, that's what happens with electricity.
He's got no feeling in
it. Yeah, he's going to be numb for a while. That's a lot of current running through him. Sit right up, though, and don't close your eyes.
Yeah, you got to keep your eyes open.
Exactly.
Dave is helped to the wheelhouse where Linda can keep a close eye on her longtime friend.
Sit up here. Hey, Simon, it's Lenny. I have a quick medical question for you. Can you hear me?
With Dave passing in and out of consciousness, Linda radios a doctor for advice.
Dave Hiltz got a pretty good jolt of 110. He was trying to plug something in and he couldn't let go of it and just about knocked him out. Yes, it's fine to lay down. He said the reason, if you get a big jolt of power like that, it can stop your heart. And that's what makes you tired.
Dave is lucky to be alive. The violent shock likely stopped his heart. Had Archie not been on deck, it could have been fatal.
Really fortunate that he didn't fall over the rail. If he'd gone in the water, not only would we never have found him, we would never have known what happened. So scary.
Dave's on bed rest, but the fishing must go on. Ship's engineer Archie takes his place, but the senior man on board hasn't worked a set out in years.
Archie's the all-around everything guy, so probably been a little while since he's found himself in the stern of the boat throwing baits, but I'm sure it's like riding a bike.
Is everything okay back there?
Years of experience are paying off, and Archie's back in the flow. As routine takes over, the crew's thoughts turn to Dave's deadly near miss.
I enjoy being out here, but
didn't feel too good seeing one of your friends from back home, you know, go down that quick.
I know, when I saw him, he didn't know where he was going to do or anything. He was just stumbling towards the rail. I mean, if he would have went over the back, nobody should notice.
Damn lucky.
Decapitation next. Coming me.
Three 300 miles from Newfoundland is the 90-foot Eagle Eye 2. Captain Scotty is hoping to add to the 38,000 pounds in his hold, but the day hasn't started well.
We're not really seeing a good run of fish. We just may have missed them. Weather may have stirred them up a bit, got them a little spooked.
Today is easy going. If we get a few more fish, it'll be better.
Yeah, small swordfish here.
Here I come to the rescue. It's a minnow. We got a minnow.
Every day is fishing day, but not every day is catching day, so.
Got about 8 more miles of gear to haul. It's all over for today.
Yeah, I think I got a problem with the main spool here. I gotta go.
Yeah.
See, hub broke.
What happened?
The hub broke.
What does that mean?
It means the hub broke. It means get out of my way. We gotta fix it.
The hub coupling on the main spool has broken. Without it, there's no way to haul back the main line.
On the left-hand side, there's a box mark coupling.
Yeah, but mark coupling, but it had nothing like this either.
We never had a replacement for that there now. There'll be a lot of us real happy today.
So if I go down there, yeah. I won't find it.
I don't know.
We'll be pulling everything in by hand. Take a very long time.
Although Daryl claims the part is not on board, Scotty wants to see for himself.
I'll order a brand new one when we get in. Never send a boat to do a man's job.
Captain Scotty must change out the broken part and replace it with a spare coupling.
This whole thing should be together. It ain't. See how the rubber's come right off of it? It's like a hub. It's a shock absorber, so the drum doesn't come to a screech and halt real bad. We just didn't really need to have it happen today. Well, if we didn't have an extra one of these shock absorbers, the trip would be over. Which probably, at this point of the game, the crew wouldn't mind that much. Neither would the captain.
No, what a snapped off right here. Right here.
Oh, yeah?
Joined together like that, right?
Yep.
Just gotta finish sealing this cover up on it, tap it in place here, and I'll just tighten up the bolts and she'll be a completed project. Okay, now we're tightening. That was about an hour fix, so, oh well. Life in the fast lane, now it's time to get the boat in the fast lane and get this gear up.
With the hub fixed, Scotty and the crew can get back to fishing. 300 miles to the northwest, Captain Chompers is guiding the Big Eye toward Newfoundland to unload his catch.
Well, we're on our way into the passing. We got a boat competing with us for the landing day. It'll contribute to bringing the market down. So we're dealing with that this morning, and now we're dealing with autopilot that doesn't work. Yeah, Big Eye's not real happy this morning.
Having lost the race to port, Chompers wants to get in and out as fast as possible.
How you getting in spring launch? Forward and after. I mean, you ain't got nobody even up here. No, don't throw that bow on. No, I don't throw that bow on. I want spring launch. After spring, same way every time. One line here, one line there. Every time, it ain't never no different. Thing. Ain't the way I want it, it's the way it's gotta be. Watch our walk back there. Gonna tear it off. Damn, we've had a 500 miles to do this. Hey, Woody, why isn't there a ball in between the boat and the dock?
Chris, I ain't the only guy on the boat.
As they start to pack out fish, veteran John Weeks is troubled by his captain's demeanor.
Was swearing at the dock in front of people on the dock. I don't think that was polite after such a hard trip and hard work that we did in the ocean. I'm gonna try to talk with him a little later. I know he told me he have a quick temper and a bad temper, but in front of people, I think you should respect your crew as your crew respect you.
...750 miles to the south, Captain Chris Clem and the Francis Ann are hauling their gear in a race against the elements.
Boats come around northwest later, 40 knots, 25 to 35 southeast today. Well, it's starting right now.
So far, they've caught less than 3,000 pounds of fish. That translates to just $500 per deckhand.
Yeah, it's picking up right now. Gear's coming back terrible today. Feels like we're parted off. What else is new? What the? Just get that beeper in the boat.
Roger.
It never fails. I don't even know what to do right now. Clear it out. Don't stand there and watch me. I know I'm cute and all, but Nightmare after nightmare.
When the weather turns out here, it turns real quick. Dave's first trip out to sea. He's never seen anything like it.
I never would have thought, you know, I got this rough, this much, this fast, you know, like, all of a sudden, bam, just waves and all kinds of stuff.
With a swell hitting 20 feet, they finally get the last of the gear on board. Now they have to hustle and get everything tied down fast.
All right, so we got the shack secure. Timing good, timing tight.
You know, it's not even as bad as it's gonna get right now. It's supposed to pick up another 20 knots or so.
Oh, this flat. Storm? Serious?
The crew gets the deck tied down, then heads for shelter. 20-foot waves and 60-knot winds are pounding the Francis Anne. The Francis Anne rides out the storm as the exhausted crew tries to catch a little shut-eye below. But a monster in the dark is about to remind them why this is one of the deadliest fishing grounds on the planet. Miles from New England, the 70-foot Francis Anne is riding out the biggest storm of the season. The crew tries to sleep as the waves batter the hull. But then a 30-foot rogue wave breaks right on top of the boat, almost rolling her over and sending men and equipment flying. The shock crew checks for damage.
That must be really good wind.
My heart is racing.
I don't
even want to think about how big that wave was. Dave got launched completely out of his bunk. Stuff was getting launched around everywhere. That was a hell of a wave. Antennas got sheared off. Thank God we weren't on deck, because we would have been swimming, I think.
The crew in the boat have survived the scare.
Yeah. You okay? Sure? Shaking up a little bit?
All right. I mean, he's not hurt, is he?
Just a little shaken up, I think.
Sounded like a cannon. Woke me up, next thing you know, I'm pinned against the wall. And I look up and I seen everything. All this stuff. All
everything. All everything that was
that side of the boat, and I seen Dave on the floor. I mean, Dave was sleeping up here, and he got launched all the way over this galley table onto the floor right there.
I was as high as the TV. Even his mattress came out.
The mattress came right with me.
I think some of us would have been swimming, if not all of us, because
Yeah, so how far do you think the boat tilted when that hit?
It was a good roll.
Too far?
Yeah, too far that I'd like to roll. When people ask me how much do you roll, I don't even like to think about that, because all I think about is capsizing, so. My heart's still pounding.
Yeah, me too.
Dave's a little banged up. Never seen that. What do you got? You bleeding a little bit? Oh, yeah, you're bleeding a little bit.
Messed up more now sweeping than I have out there, you know? Oh, man.
Lemmy takes the watch as the rest of the crew try to get back to sleep.
It's 20 foot waves right now. It's blowing 60 probably. And right now all I can see is just big black waves. Picked up the 70 something foot boat and launched it the other way. But right now I definitely feel small after that wave. Northeast Atlantic in October. It's nasty out here. It's time of the year. It's not nice. The risk we all take coming out here.
Crazy. 1,200 miles from New England, the Seahawk is getting ready for their third haul back of the trip.
Normally, we'd have a section of gear aboard by now. We haven't even started. Quite a bit of tide here. We're about 18 miles from where we set this end last night.
Oh, Archie, I just got electrocuted. Where?
Yesterday, deckhand Dave Hiltz was electrocuted.
So what was the shock going in your back there?
Today, he'll get back to work.
Dave seems to have come out of it just, he's sore. I guess he's sore, but man, if that's his only problem, I think very lucky.
Oh man, I got a friggin' headache. I'm gonna quit.
Linda has a headache too. There's not enough fish in the hole, and her season's fading away.
There you go, Nate. It won't be too bad, right?
Fine.
Perfect.
Good.
We're good to go.
It's not long before the first bite. It's a 100-pound swordfish.
Still hurts. Like down here in my shoulder.
Hey! Wild.
It's a Mako!
Archer, let me hook him.
Come on. Good job.
But Dave is struggling.
Doesn't feel like I have the strength. Just feeling weird. Everything feels weird.
A little far back.
Nice. He was eating some of that seaweed.
Yeah. We're catching nothing. We got two little rats back there. We have two fish.
Linda's desperate for more than two fish, but it seems the curse of the Seahawk has returned.
The card box?
We're getting whacked.
Found the end, Lenny.
A part off.
I run the boat after tonight. Lenny said, you heard that, Arch. You think we're doing bad today?
The gear has drifted off the currents, and there's no telling how long it'll take to find it.
But we're just headed to the furthest end. It's got a light on it, and we can find it, and then we'll just walk.
the bow.
Hours after starting the haul back, they can once again start fishing. But the last 200 hooks bring up just one small fish. The crew reaches the end of the line, and despite a miserable day of fishing, they keep their sense of humor.
This is ruining my life!
As the end of the fishing season draws near, the Seahawk will have to pull out all the stops to fill their hold with swords.
It's original.